happy to have Marcos Marino from Geneva. He's going to tell us about resurgence, BPS counting, and not invariants. Go ahead, Marcos. Thanks for being here.
So, thank you. So, let me share my screen. So, is everybody seeing correctly my screen?
Yes, it looks perfectly fine.
Okay. Okay, well, first of all, let me thank you for organizing this great conference, which shows that resurgence is good and well. So I will be talking about a particular problem in resurgence that we were looking at recently, but I will try also to make some kind of more general comments on the more mathematical side of resurgence. So my talk will be on resurgence, BPS counting, and not invariants. So the starting point of resurgence is always perturbation theory. One of the reasons is that perturbation theory in a small parameter remains one of the most fruitful approaches to quantum theories. But one of the things that we learn with resurgence is that a perturbative series actually has much more information that we could think naively. And by appropriate decoding of the perturbative series, we can find a lot of additional information. And in particular, we can find information on additional sectors of the path integral. And also from the mathematical point of view, I have to say that this decoding involves a very beautiful and challenging mathematics. And the starting point of this mathematics, as I will explain later on, is an operation which takes you from the world of perturbative series, which are typically divergent series, to the world of analytic complex functions under underlying geometry. So, Now, I will show in this talk that the resurgent structure of perturbative series involves, in some cases, a very beautiful integrality structure. And when we see integers in physics, many of us think that this would be counting something. And it turns out that in many cases, this integrality structure appearing in resurgence can be physically interpreted in terms of counting BPS states in a dual theory. And there are two very interesting examples of such a situation. One is complex transimons theory, and the other is topological string theory. So in this talk, I will actually focus on the first one, on complex transimons theory. And I have to say that this work is based on a paper we posted yesterday with my long-term collaborators and friends, Stavros Garoufalidis and Diego. Okay. So what is the starting point of this story? Well, the starting point of this story are divergent series, factorially divergent series of this type. These are formal power series in which the coefficients an grow factorially. And the way to make sense of this series in resurgence is the method of Borel, the method of Borel resummation. But Borel resummation has actually two steps. Now, it has a first step, which is called the Borel transform. And this is what I was mentioning before. The Borel transform takes you from the world of factorially divergent series to the world of convergent series at the origin, analytic functions at the origin, by just doing something as simple as divided an by n factorial. When you do this, you cut the factorial divergence of the series and you get a holomorphic function of the origin. This is actually the only thing I will need in this talk, but of course, once you have the Borel transform, you can recover a well-defined function by doing this operation of Borel resummation. But I won't actually not need Borel resummation for my exposition. So as I was saying, the Borel transform is analytic at the origin. But what is interesting is what happens when you analytically continue this function to the complex plane. And when you do that, you will find that outside of a region of convergence around the origin, you have all kinds of singularities, which can be poles or branch cuts and so on. So this is actually very important because this is the structure of singularities that will give us this additional information that we want. And these singularities occur in the variable of the Borel transform, which is usually called the Borel plane. So, how do you decode additional information? So the idea is very simple. The idea is to see what happens near the singularities of this Borel transform. So I will assume for the purpose of this talk that the singularities are actually of the log type. And so these are logarithmic singularities. So let's assume that we have a singularity at a given point, zeta omega, in the Borel plane. And let's try to make an expansion of this Borel transform around this singularity. Now, what you find when you do that is the following. You find the logarithmic singularity. This is multiplying a power series expanding around this singular point. So this is the series f hat, phi hat omega. And then you will have a coefficient here. And this coefficient is usually called a Stokes constant. And this power series turns out to be the Borel transform of another series, phi omega, in which the coefficients also typically grow factorially. So as you see, by looking at the singularities in the Borel plane, we can actually find new perturbative series, in this case, all these fi omega here, which are associated typically to new sectors of the series. So this could be, for example, expansions around different saddle points, or they could be even more complicated things. I mean, for example, renormalons in asymptotically free theories can also be decoded in this way. So essentially, if you are given a perturbative series, this is not the end of the story. You can actually get, by looking at the singularities in the Borel plane, many different perturbative series. So now you can do again this operation. From all these series that you are finding, you can do again the same thing, look at their singularities, look at what are the expansions of these singularities locally. And then when you do that, you will get a set of formal power series. And this formal power series will have will form some sort of closed system. So this system of formal power series will be characterized by a label, a label for the sector. So these are the series that you will obtain in this way. I will denote it by phi omega z. And very importantly, you will find associated to all these series a matrix of Stokes constants. So remember that the Stokes constant appear when you do the local expansion. So when you do this for all the series appearing in the game, you will find a matrix which relates, which tells you how the singularities of phi omega relate to the series phi omega prime. Now, so this is actually the kind of hidden information that you find in a perturbative series, but extracting all this information in a given physical theory is not easy, to put it mildly. And one of the things that you find when you do this kind of game is that the Stokes constants are often very complicated numbers. So for example, if you do the calculation in say Panleve type equations, you will find that these are irrational numbers. And actually Ricardo has recent results on the Stokes constant for this type of Panleve equations, which show that they are transcendental numbers. However, in some cases, these Stokes constants are actually very simple. They are integers. And this, in very elementary examples, this has a geometric interpretation in terms of intersection of integration paths. And this is something that Maxim Konsevich was reminded us in his talk yesterday. So let me actually show you an example in which these Stokes constants are actually integer numbers. And this is the one of the kind of classical examples of resurgence, which is the exact WKB method. Now I will be brief here. I just want to mention how the integer constants appearing here relate to something deeper. So let me just review this a little bit quickly. So the formal power series, the set of formal power series phi omega that appear in this exact WKB method are what are called exponentiated quantum periods or Borel symbols. So in exact WKB method, you start with a WKB curve, which involves the Hamiltonian in quantum mechanics minus the energy equal to zero. So this curve will have a set of one cycles. And you can integrate the quantum deformation of the momentum around these cycles. And in this way, you find quantum periods, which are formal power series in h bar square. And these are the formal power series that appear in the Resurgent analysis of the WKB method. And once you exponentiate these quantum periods, you get these famous Borel symbols, which are, again, formal power series in h bar square. Now, once you do this game, you can you will have a matrix of Stokes constants associated to these Borel symbols, These matrices of Stokes constants are integers that can be computed with the exact WKB method. This was done in very beautiful developments in the 90s by André Boroz, Ecalle, De La Vaelle, Dieringer Fan, and many other people. And one of the nice results that you find is that there is a wall-crossing structure for this Stokes constant. So, you know, everything here depends on the moduli of the curve in chambers. And there was a very beautiful recent development, which actually gave a highly surprising interpretation for these Stokes constants with our integers. So suppose for a moment that this WKB curve, which in quantum mechanics is just a classical Hamiltonian, can be interpreted as a cyber-Witten curve for a supersymmetric theory. Now, one of the consequences of the work of Gayoto Muranitsky, who analyzed this problem of this supersymmetric theory with WKB techniques, is that the Stokes constants, which are integers, are actually integers for a very good reason. They compute BPS multiplicities in this supersymmetric theory. So you have actually a very simple formula, which is that the Stokes constant related to the sectors gamma and gamma prime is up to a geometric factor, which is the intersection of gamma and gamma prime, proportional to the number of BPS states in the class gamma prime. So in this case, the reason, in a sense, why these Stokes constants are integers is deeply related to the structure of counting of states in a dual theory, in this case, a supersymmetric theory, which shares this WKB curve with a quantum mechanical problem. So what I'm going to tell you today is a sort of similar story, but in a slightly more complicated setting, which occurs in the context of complex transheimer theory. So why complex transheimer theory? Well, I think Sergei Gukov gave a very nice talk yesterday in which he actually explained very well why we should look at complex transheimer theory. The reason is simply because this is a very rich source of perturbative series and at the same time of beautiful mathematics. So I'm going to consider complex transheimer theory on a three manifold M, but for various reasons, I will restrict myself to a very important case, which is when the three manifold M is the complement of a hyperbolic knot. And the reason for doing this is that it has been argued that in this case, the partition function of complex transheimer theory reduces to a finite dimensional integral. This was based on work which goes a long way back to Kashaev, but it was put forward by Hikami and by Dimov, De Gukov, Lenes, and Sagir. And more recently, this state integral has been put in completely rigorous footing by Andersen and Kashaev. So we have now a rigorous definition of this state integral invariants of complements of hyperbolic knots, thanks to the work of Andersen and Kashaev. So I'm not going to give you all the details of how you construct this state integral, but it's just important. There are two important ingredients, or maybe three important ingredients. The first one is that this is really a finite dimensional integral. So it's something that you can compute. It's not a path integral. So the path integral has collapsed to a finite dimensional integral. The second ingredient is that it depends on a coupling constant tau, which you can interpret here as h bar. And the theory of these state integrals says that the domain of this tau coupling constant is actually the whole complex plane except the negative real axis. So this is well defined for any value of tau in this cut plane. And maybe the third ingredient is that the building block of this integral is Fadeje's quantum dilogarithm. And this actually gives rise to some of the peculiar phenomena that characterize this integral. So I will focus also on the simplest case, which is the gauge group SL2Z. Okay. There is probably a story where you can take a higher rank gauge group, but I won't consider it here. Okay. So what do you do with these state integrals? Well, these state integrals are actually path integrals, are supposed to be path integrals of complex transheimer theory. So you can study their saddle points, and the saddle points of these finite dimensional integrals correspond to critical points of the complex transheimer theory, which are flat complex connection sigma on this three manifold M. So these are the traditional saddle points of this theory. When you do an expansion around a saddle point, you will find an exponential with the value of the classical action. So this is a complex transcendental theory, so the classical action is complex. And then you will have a power series phi sigma of tau, which is a power series in powers of tau, which is going to be a factorially divergent series. So for any choice of flat connection, for any choice of classical solution, you will end up with a factorially divergent series. Here there should be a tau. There is a tau missing here in the denominator. Sorry. So these are the perturbative series that you can analyze, and these are the kind of series that you could actually study with resurgent methods. Now, let me make an important point, is that if you think about a hyperbolic knot, the complement of a hyperbolic knot, there will be many saddle points, there will be many flat complex connections. But among these connections, there is always a very specific connection, which is called sometimes the geometric connection. And this corresponds to the geodesically completed hyperbolic metric on M. And since we are in a complex theory, the conjugate of this geometric connection also exists. And then the value of this real part of the classical action is a very important invariant of M, is the hyperbolic volume. Okay. So you see that when you do the state integral expansion around the saddle points, there will be specific saddle points will give you hyperbolic volume. And this is actually the way in which the state integral incorporates this volume conjecture due to Kasai. Very good. So we have a gauge theory, a complex gauge theory. We have a way to calculate this partition function in a very concrete way through finite dimensional integrals. And we will have associated to all saddle points factorially divergent series. So this is the perfect stage for doing resurgence. Let me give you a concrete example of how this looks like. So I will focus for most of my talk on the simplest hyperbolic knot, which is this famous figure eight knot. So there are, in this case, for the figure eight knot, there are in this case only two saddle points, which are just the geometric and the conjugate connection. And if you can actually compute these series, as Sergey was mentioning yesterday, this can be computed. You cannot compute it, there are limits to what you can compute. So actually, we were able to compute only 300 terms of this series. But you can compute it. And let me point out that the expansion, the power series expansion of phi g, the geometric connection, agrees actually with the all orders expansion of the Kasaev invariant. And in this case, there is a very simple symmetry which relates the power series associated to the geometric connection and the power series associated to the complex connection. So which is just exchanging tau by minus tau. Now, if you look at the Borel plane for this power series, you will find that phi g of tau, you will find, first of all, like very typical singularities. Now, you have an integral and you have different saddle points. Typically, you expect to find in the Borel plane the difference between the actions. So here, for example, for the geometric saddle point, you expect to find the difference between its action and the action of the other point, and vice versa. For this series here, you expect to find the action of the conjugate point minus the action of the geometric point. So you expect to find in a classical expansion of an integral and its other points these sort of singularities, and you actually find them. And this is part of the story, but there is much more to the story. Let me just mention that this sort of classical part of the story, in which you have these classical singularities typical of saddle point integrals, this was analyzed in my paper with Sergey and Putrov, and was also studied by Gang and Achud and Garufalidis and Sagir. But as I was mentioning, there is an extra ingredient to this story, which was also mentioned by both Maxim and Sergey, and is the fact that the Chern-Simons action is multivalued. This is actually also reflected in the state integral. When you do a state integral, you will see that the classical potential is actually a dilogarithm function. This comes from the classical limit of the quantum dilogarithm. And then you will have this multivalueness also built in this state integral. So the most important consequence of this is that you have infinite towers of additional singularities, which correspond to the multivaluedness of the Chern-Simons action. So this is the complex Chern-Simons action, but the multivaluedness tells you that there will be an additional tower of actions which are separated by 2 pi I. So you will find vertical lines of singularities on top of these classical singularities that I was showing you before. And this is, in a sense, this is quite surprising, because although this problem starts like a finite dimensional problem, it has these kind of infinite towers of singularities which are typical of nonlinear problems. So the picture you get of singularities is actually this one. So you have a tower of singularities always on top of the origin, and a tower of singularities on top of the classical singularity that you would have predicted based on the study of saddle point integrals. And so this is not drawing the scale, so but the here the separation between these singularities is 2 pi I. Okay, so you have these tower of singularities. And let me actually mention that I think also Sergei mentioned this yesterday, that these infinite towers of singularities appear every time you are dealing with a sort of exponential problem. So, for example, a context in which this also appears is in topological string theory on torical avian manifolds. This was first pointed out by Pasquetti and Schiappa in a very nice paper, and has been studied often, have been shown very often that you will have these towers of singularities. But I have to say that for me, these towers of singularities were always a little bit mysterious, because in a sense, multivariateness looked like something very simple. So also you see these singularities when you actually calculate this, when you look actually at the Borel plane of this series. It's, it has been always very surprising to me what is the actual content of this. If there is any interesting content to this. But let's follow what Resurgence tells you. So what does Resurgence tell you? Well, Resurgence tells you that if you have singularities, then this means that this corresponds to non-perturbative corrections. And actually, it's very easy to see that if you have a singularity at 2 pi I n in the Borel plane, this means that you will have a tiny non-perturbative correction, which is going to be given by this q twiddle to the n, and this q twiddle has a typical e to the minus a over h bar form. The only thing is that now the action here is going to be imaginary, but this means that as soon as tau, remember that tau is not necessarily real, tau is going to live in the complex plane. As soon as tau is actually in the upper or the lower half plane, these non-perturbative corrections will be turned on. Okay? So there are all these small non-perturbative corrections, which are actually very small. If you look at the relative values, you will see that they are really very small corrections. Now, but Resurgence tells you that you have to take these singularities very seriously. So the tower of the singularities in the Borel plane are going to be labeled by two indices. One index will refer to the flat connection that you are looking at, and the other index will actually be labeling this additional multivaluedness, this integer, additional integer that appears here. So you want this n is going to label which point in the tower you are looking at. And in particular, there's going to be an infinite matrix of Stokes constants, which will be also labeled by these two numbers. So the number of sigma prime is, of course, finite. This is the number of classical saddle points of the Chern-Simons theory. But then you will have these two additional integers. As I was mentioning before, one could think that these towers of singularities are somewhat trivial because they come from very simple multivariants. And actually, it's very easy to see that the formal power series associated to them are very simple. In a sense, the only source of a non-trivial power series here are the power series that you obtain when you span the integral. This is a kind of very elementary exercise. And then the only thing you can do in order to incorporate this n is to multiply by q twiddle to the n. So this is just modifying the action, but it's not modifying the expansion itself. So this looks like this is kind of a very trivial effect, but as you will see, it's not so trivial. Now, if you use this form of the formal power series, you will immediately notice that this Stokes constant, they actually only depends on one single integer. It does not really depend on two, because you can always multiply by q to the n to obtain the remaining integer. So it only depends on the difference between the integers n and n prime. So I can focus on this quantity here. Now, again, you could think that you know, all these towers of singularities will be trivial, but when you do explicit computations, what you find is, first of all, that these Stokes constants are integers, and second, that they form a highly non-trivial collection of integer invariants of the norm. And let me actually emphasize that these are integer invariants of the norm, because you are starting with an invariant of the norm, which is the complex transimous path integral. You are looking at the structure, resulting structure of the perturbative series, which are also invariants of the norm, and then you are extracting integers out of them. So these integers that you can actually associate to all these singularities, these are the Stokes numbers here for these singularities, are actually integer invariants of the norm. And you can calculate them and you find highly non-trivial numbers, positive and negative integers. And these are new invariants of the norm, in principle. Now, when you do the calculations, you can, I mean, by doing explicit calculations, you can actually only calculate a finite number of these integers. But the question is, can we actually identify them? Can we actually guess them? I mean, there are cases in the literature in which people have been able to compute many Stokes constants because, you know, the situation was easy enough that you know, for example, the exact Borel transform and so on. But this is a case in which you don't really know the exact Borel transform of this series. I mean, you know many terms, but you don't have that much analytic control. So the question is, what are these numbers? Is there any structure behind these numbers? So if you have looked at these numbers long enough and you have read the right papers, you can immediately realize that, this tower here, so if you look at the towers associated to the geometric series, so this is the geometric flat connection, this tower here appearing here turns out to be identifiable as numbers that appear in another very different quantity, which is this famous Dimov-Tegayotto-Gukov index. So what is going on here? Now, if you have a hyperbolic knot inside S3, Dimov-Tegayotto and Gukov argued some time ago that you can actually associate this geometric configuration a dual three-dimensional superconformal field. So every given any hyperbolic knot, there is a 3D superconformal field theory that you can consider. And this 3D superconformal field theory has BPS states, and they introduce an index to count these BPS states. So it turns out that these numbers that appear here as Stokes constants are actually numbers appearing in the expansion of this BPS index. So this is actually a particular case of their index. It's the case in which you take the magnetic number equal to zero and you sum over all electric numbers. So this 8 here, it's computing a number of BPS states, this minus 9 here as well, and so on. So this is, of course, a weighted counting of BPS states. And then we have already identified them, what are the numbers appearing here. Okay. So this is, again, a picture very similar to the one that you find in WKB. I mean, you are calculating, you are doing a resurgent analysis of power series, you are finding integers, and the kind of deep reason behind the integrality of these Stokes constants seem to be a BPS counting in a dual theory. Now, of course, we would like to describe all of these towers. So this tower here, remember, is identified with this Dimov-Tegayotto-Gukov index. But remember that there were additional towers here. I mean, there are also towers in the lower half plane. But you can see, you can show that they are related to these towers here. So there are actually three independent towers if you look at this. So there is this tower here. This tower and this tower differ only in sign, and then there is an additional tower here. So you have three, or if you want, four towers to identify. And actually, we were able to identify this by developing a very nice theory, which was very much developed by Garufalidis and Kashaev and Garufalidis and Sagir. And the way to actually identify these towers of numbers is actually to use what is called the block decomposition of the state integral. So essentially, in the physics literature, this is sometimes called the holomorphic block decomposition. But what I want to make clear here is that we have a complete description, a complete mathematical description of these towers of numbers. Mm-hmm. And the description in the case of the figure I note is the following. So let's consider the following linear codifference equation here. Mm-hmm. So this is a very simple linear codifference equation, which is reminiscent of these A polynomial equations that A hat equations that people use in three manifold topology. Then our statement, our conjecture is that the Stokes numbers, which can be actually put in Q series by this very simple device, you just package all these numbers into a Q series, which is also suggested by this connection to the index. So these Stokes Q series are actually given by explicit bilinear expressions in fundamental solutions of this equation. Okay, so this is our conjecture. And just to show you that we have the numbers, let me just flash to you this transparency very quickly. So we have been using this principle, have been able to construct explicit Q series, which are relatively complicated. So let me not go into the details. And this S matrix, for example, plus can be constructed explicitly in terms of bilinears in these solutions. G plus, G plus, G minus, G plus are solutions, are particular combinations of these fundamental solutions. Here lambda is an integer. And you can actually see that this gives you these towers of numbers. And we have obtained similar explicit results for the 5-2 knot. Of course, our general conjecture is that this is valid for all hyperbolic knots. So let me state this conjecture for you. So our conjecture has two parts. The first part says that when you look at the Stokes constant related to the geometric connection, remember that this geometric connection is very important in hyperbolic geometry, is the one related to the Kasaev invariant. This Stokes Q matrix is actually the DGG index, up to subtracting minus one by convention. And all the Stokes Q series, all the entries of these matrices are actually bilinear expressions in solutions to a linear difference equation. And this linear difference equation can be actually obtained by looking to the block decomposition of the state integral. And I have to say that, as you probably have noticed, related results were recently announced by Konsevich. So Konsevich has been looking at this kind of problem, and he has been also relating this to some sort of monodromy of a Q difference equations, but in our case we have a complete description of this problem for hyperbolic knots. Let me mention also that this sort of Stokes Q series have been computed previously in the case of compact transimon theory in some cipherspaces. So this was done by Kostin and Garufalidis, and actually by using a Q series in my paper with Gukov and Putrov. But in a sense, this is a much simpler case because for these cipher spaces, you really have a completely explicit description of the Borel transform. So you just have to look at the poles of this expression and you will be able to extract those constants, which are actually typically plus or minus one or zero. So the situation is much simpler here. So the situation for complex transimon theory hyperbolic knots is much more complicated, but we believe that we have a complete description of this problem. Okay, so let me come to the conclusions. So the first general thing that we already knew is that resurgence can be used to extract very, very beautiful information from perturbative series. So essentially perturbative series are the tip of an iceberg in which you will have many different sectors. And very importantly, you have these matrices of Stokes constants, which are very interesting. And in some cases, they lead to non-trivial integer invariants. And let me emphasize that this is a kind of very well-defined and new route to integrality. Because after all, what is the input here? The input here are perturbative series. And these perturbative series are not given, they are not involving integer invariants. They involve rational numbers and also irrational numbers appearing in the field in the trace field of the knot. So, for example, for the figure A knot, you will have the square roots of three around, and if you look at the figure 5-2 knot, you will have even more complicated roots. But the Stokes constants are actually integers. So this gives a root in which you start with non-integer invariants of the knot, and you end up with integer invariants of the knot. This is an alternative and different from, for example, what Sergey was mentioning yesterday, which is Q-series based on radial asymptotics. So the idea of the Q-series based on radial asymptotics is that given a perturbative series, you will construct a series, a Q-series with integer coefficients such that when you expand the Qs, you are going to find the non-integer invariants that you started with. But as I was mentioning yesterday in Sergey's talk, this is not really uniquely defined. So given a perturbative series, you can get many different Q series with the same radial asymptotics. While here, the Stokes integers are completely uniquely defined. I mean, once you are given the system of perturbative series, the Stokes constants are completely well defined. So this gives you really a well-defined set of integer invariants. And not surprisingly, these integer invariants turn out to be related to known invariants of the node, like the DGG index. Now, I want to emphasize that this gives you these results, which are conjecturally mostly, but they determine the complete resurgent structure of compressed transcendence theory for hyperbolic nodes. So, you know, once you're giving all these Stokes constants, this is all the information that resurgence can give you. I mean, this gives you all the Stokes automorphisms, all the alien varieties, and so on. And I think it's a very beautiful fact that there is a close relationship with BPS counting. Not all the powers that I showed you have been identified in terms of indexes, but we think that this can be eventually done by using our explicit description. Now, as I said, very similar structures are appearing in topological string theory and topological Abelian manifolds, but it's not clear to me yet what is the numerative meaning of this Stokes constant that appear there, that they might give you some sort of new BPS invariance for Calabi-Yaus, at least in the toric case. Now, let me list finally some open questions. For those of you who know the subject, you see that our series were just numerical series, and this means that we are not turning on the formations of the hyperbolic structure. So what you can do is to deform the series to series depending on a parameter, which is the formation of the hyperbolic structure, which is related to the holonomy of the gauge connection around the node. And it would be very interesting to generalize our analysis. And maybe when we do this, we will have a clear relationship between our linear equation and the famous A polynomial and the A hat operator. Now, I made a parallelism with what happens in exact WKB. So in exact WKB, we have a curve, and we could extract those constants from the curve. And this is some of the things that Gaiotto, Mura, and Mitske have developed. So one natural question is that can you actually extract all these Stokes constants from a WKB analysis of, say, the A polynomial or a some related object in the way that GMN did? Another point of view, which is very interesting, which is related to what also Konsevich was mentioning yesterday, once you have all these Stokes constants, you can, in a sense, reformulate the state integral invariants themselves. You can essentially rewrite the Borel resummation of the perturbative series in terms of this Stokes constant. This is this Riemann-Hilbert problem that Maxime was presenting yesterday. And this is, in a sense, an alternative to Borel resummation in the sense that you don't really have to you don't have to produce the perturbative series and then resum it. Just by giving the structure of the Stokes rays, you will be able to solve a Riemann-Hilbert problem, and this will determine the Borel resum series and the invariants directly. So it will be very interesting to now come back to the integral invariants by using this problem. And finally, we don't have a mathematical proof of these conjectures, and also physically, I think they are very—they are still mysterious to me. We are doing this perturbative series of around hyperbolic nodes, and we are finding these BPS invariants. I don't think this is completely obvious. From the point of view of compressed transcendence theory, this is relating a theory with a value of the level, transcendence level, with a theory with another value of the transcendence level. So this is not completely obvious to me. But I think, you know, there should be a sort of physical argument to make a relationship between these two theories. Okay, I think that's all. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Marcos. That was a wonderful talk. I'm sure everybody's clapping right now, so let me not do the only clapping thing. So for questions, just please raise your hands. I will see it here, and in the good old KITP spirit, we should be having a long discussion of 15, 20 minutes. I will see and call them out. And I think the first was Arkady. You can now talk and make your question.
Hi, Marcus. Thanks for the talk. Okay, I'm trying to return to the question that I asked Sergei yesterday about, it's related to what you call physical interpretation of this, because when you are showing this, a relation to, say, finite integrals, it comes to the point that your original in certain way, like Sergei Bukov argues that it is kind of gauge theory. So it's a field theory with an infinite number of degrees of freedom, all this stuff. When you are related to this kind of type of finite integrals, it reminds that it's in certain sector, like BPS sector, right, of the theory, it could be much less much less degrees of freedom than in original gauge theory. So which could be related to your last questions about physical interpretation, right? I wonder, about your comments on this issue.
Yes. So absolutely. So first of all, this is a topological gauge theory. It's complex transimons.
Yeah.
So it's slightly more complicated than compact transimons, because indeed the Hilbert spaces are infinite dimensional, and that's why you have integrals. In compact transimons theory, you wouldn't even have integrals. You would have just sums over a finite number of states. Here you have integrals, but indeed it's a quite non-trivial fact, and it's due to the topological nature of transimons that you can reduce this to a finite dimensional integral. So this is still, of course, is like a toy model of an actual gauge theory, right? I completely agree. And indeed, I think your intuition is completely right, and that's also related to the fact that we are finding a relation to a three-dimensional supersymmetric theory. And actually, it's part of this 3D correspondence that these state integrals are related to localized path integrals in supersymmetric gauge theory. So you can think about this theory as a very simple gauge theory, either because it's topological or because it's supersymmetric in this dual description. So indeed, these are very, very much toy models. But still, this problem of calculating these Stokes constants is a difficult problem. I mean, of course, I wish we could do this for QCD, but I don't know if this is something in the foreseeable future.
I'm wondering if you can, in this way, present some kind of another kind of dual physical theory, which would lead to the same kind of, result, at least in the sector you are discussing. What is the alternative to original formulation? I mean, some kind of dual.
Yes. I think in principle, this perturbative series that I'm computing could be reinterpreted in terms of this three-dimensional superconformal field theory of Gaiotto, Gukov, and Dimofte. So in principle, yeah, you could have this dual description for this series. But you would have the same time. I mean, the problem is very well mathematically defined. You have just this... this is those constants, and you want to calculate them.
Okay, so the next question is by Davide. Go ahead, you can talk.
Hi. So, hi. In the talk, you focused on the sum for knots, but I guess you could have a similar question for the state partition function of some generic trinary culture theory, and perhaps a relation to the index.
Yes, absolutely. I mean, the only reason why we focus on there were many reasons, but first of all, these are very kind of much studied. And I think, again, I'm not a total expert on complex transimons, but my understanding is that the state integral representation is actually well established only for complements of hyperbolic knots, if I understand correctly. There are also some papers in which people have done the same thing for cipher manifolds like Blau and Thompson, but for the case of knots, this this state integral is rigorously defined as an invariant, and that's why we focus on this. But indeed, I mean, one could do the same analysis, or one could think about these integer invariants given by Stokes constants for any manifold.
But why manifolds? Couldn't you just take Yuan-Chasimons in 3D n equal 2, Yuan-Chasimons at some level coupled to a single chiral?
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. I mean, I could, for example, study a partition function on S3 with a deformation. Yeah. I could definitely do this. Yeah. And I could formulate the same problem. Indeed, for this hyperbolic nonce, this would be an integral in that case. Yeah, this would be this dual formulation. Absolutely. But still, it's not clear to me why the Stokes constants should be related to the index of the theory. I mean, that's not completely clear. I mean, it's a natural answer, but just knowing exactly what is this, I think it's not trivial. And then you also have to remember that there are also all these other towers which are not so directly related to the index. The relation to the index is not so clear.
It would be nice to know if this is just a property of 3D equal to theories, or if it indicates some deeper dualities.
Yes, absolutely.
All right, Sergei, go ahead, you're next.
Hi, Marcos, this was great.
Hi.
Since electric version of the DGG index appeared, and also from perspective of the perturbation of Trans-Simons theory, it would be natural to expect that this Stokes coefficients can be expressed in terms of some classical invariants, like torsion of the flat connection, or differences of row invariants. Did you try to compare?
No, I mean, what we have been trying to do, I mean, first of all, as I mentioned at the end, the fact that we are not turning a deformation of the hyperbolic structure means that we are at a very specific point. So this might actually be not the best point to understand the relationship with the whole construction. So I think what we have to do is to turn on this hyperbolic structure and see how, and see maybe, for example, these linear recursions are more identifiable in terms of the A hat operator. That's one thing. And the second thing is that just using the index is not enough to reproduce all the towers. So you need to have what we call in the paper descendants of the state integral. So we have to, in a sense, generate a different version of the index, a more general version of the index, which probably, when you turn on the X parameter, can be understood in a clearer way. So in order to make the picture with the index clearer, I think we should turn on this deformation of the hyperbolic structure.
Well, what I mean is that even before we turn on deformation, that this integers, this particular version of DGG index only in the electric sector where magnetic flux is turned off,
yes,
or the other constants, I mean, maybe they could be expressed in terms of a classical invariance of flat connection, which is a row invariance, for example.
Yes, but you see, I mean, the perturbative invariants themselves are supposed to be expressed in terms of, you know, something more classical. But yeah, the Stokes constants are in a sense different. First of all, they are, yeah. I mean, I don't know really how to match them with kind of more classical invariants. I haven't really thought very much about this prospect.
All right, let's keep going. So Marcel, you're up.
Hi, Marcos.
Hi.
Just to make sure I understand this. When you have these towers of singularities, if you would write down a trend series solution, then I guess you would write down a sector for each of these singularities.
Yes, absolutely. But
would then the coefficients, the non-perturbative ambiguities, would they be related, or would they be independent parameters?
No, in principle, that depends on what you want to calculate. Now, the Stokes constants, of course, are all different, and this is what gives you this Stokes Q series, right? So this is already the Stokes constants are not related among them. I mean, you can generate them with a single formula, but they are all these integers. So now, Now, what I mean, I think your question is very interesting in the sense that, in the following sense, imagine that you want to express one physical, clear physical quantity in terms of this transseries. I mean, what are going to be the precise coefficients of all these sectors? Are going to be related or not? I mean, in general, they are going to be Q series, and maybe you can find a kind of algorithm to generate all these integers, but in principle, they are going to be different. I mean, there's not going to be an easy relation in the sense that you have to generate them through a non-trivial Q-series, right? So that would be kind of my first guess.
So it's not like in non-linear problems where you have different sectors, but they get multiplied by the sigma squared, sigma cubed. And so
No. Which is, I mean, you can generate these numbers, but these are the functions that I saw here, right? So these are these functions that I show here. These give you all the coefficients, but it's not a simple operation. Mm.
Okay, thank you. Ian, you're up. Go ahead.
Yeah, okay. Hi, Marcus. I have two sort of mathematical questions. So one, you mentioned some count of BPS indices, which probably also Sergei can comment on. What geometrically do you count?
Well, geometrically, I think this index is related to counting of surfaces in the three manifold, if I remember correctly. But again, probably Sergei can tell you more about that, because this is not a subject in which I have been working for a long time. But I think geometrically you can interpret this index in terms of counting of surfaces in some situations. Yeah. Of
with some prescribed boundary, yeah.
Yeah, I think these are called normal surfaces or something like that. Yeah.
It is known that this generating function which you wrote, it satisfies some difference equation, not Q difference. Because that's the second question which a bit confuses me. And that story which Maxim explained, he spoke about Q difference equations, and I understand how they appear in relation to complexified Chern-Simons. Yeah, you just quantize, for example, your polynomials. But you wrote also difference equations when you went. Okay, so.
So this difference equation that I wrote here, it plays the role sort of, it's a sort of version of the polynomial for this particular value of the hyperbolic structure. This is, again, remember that I'm turning off the hyperbolic structure. And this is the Q difference equation. Also, the way this Q difference equation was found was by analyzing this splitting, holomorphic, anti-holomorphic splitting of the state integral. This is how originally Garufalidis and Kashai found this equation. Now, as I say, the relationship between this type of Q-difference equations and the A-hat polynomial is not completely clear to me, because we are in a very specific point in the modular space of hyperbolic structures. So this gives you the solution, and there is a way of finding these Q-difference equations, but as I said, in order to find a kind of the full picture, I think turning the deformation will be very useful.
Okay, all right, thank you.
Okay, let's move on. Ovidio, you're up. Go ahead.
Ovidio. Yeah. So this was a very, very nice talk. My question is, I have a question and a comment. The question is basically from the pure angle of resurgence. What I see in your Bonner plane is something so extremely unusual. I haven't seen something like that. So in terms of these towers of singularities, for those of you who are not familiar, so they come indeed from the non-linearity of a given problem, in which if you do a formal expansion and you generate an exponential, say e to the minus x, by squaring and so on, you generate e to the minus 2x and so on.
Yes.
Generate a tower. And by Stokes' phenomena, you see the duality between singularities and these equally spaced things. But normally they come aligned along rays starting at the origin and not two parallel sort of structures. And I wonder whether this is something that comes from the Bonner plane, or there is this extra structure of the dialogue in the physical domain that triggers this funny thing.
Yeah, well, of course, there will be a Stokes race in the tau plane. The singularities are in the Borel plane. Now, each of these singularities leads to a ray in the tau plane, and these rays actually accumulate. The infinite rays accumulate near the imaginary axis. Actually, this also was something that Maxime Conserge mentioned yesterday. Okay, so there will be a Stokes race. Yeah, the origin of this is this multivalence. This is why, in a sense, for me, it was a surprise that these integers are so non-trivial, right? Because it's a very mild, this multivalence is very mild, right? Still, it has all this very rich structure. So for me, it was a surprise. But we are going to find this structure in many other examples, including topological strings, supersymmetric, super conformal theories in three dimensions, and so on. That's cool.
Right. And so the comment refers exactly to this difference, Q difference equation. Possibly you look into that, but it's a three-step recurrence, and it allows for a continued fractional representation of the solution, which is a very powerful analytic tool to understand the structure of the function of Q. And furthermore, whenever you truncate that continued fraction, three-step, you get exactly the Padé approximant of Ym as a function of Q.
I see.
Which is
very good. Yeah. Now that you are asking me this, I have to mention that the fact that the Q series, these Q series are convergent. So actually, this is a manifestation of something that you pointed out in your papers. I mean, one of the things that I learned from your papers is that you can reorganize the transseries by looking for a given power of tau, you get to look at all the exponentials, right? It's one of the things that you give in one, and you find this, and you actually show that very often this series of exponentials are actually convergent, right? So here, the series of exponentials is this Q series appearing in the Stokes matrices. And of course, they are convergent. They have a finite radius of convergence. And this is actually, in a sense, a manifestation of your principle in a case in which the rest of the transseries is, in a sense, trivial. Because you see, because of this fact, the only thing you get when you put together the exponentials are series in Q twitters, right? And this is, in a sense, a very nice example of the kind of reorganization of the transseries that you were suggesting.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, all right. Well, very interesting. Thank you very much. Yeah.
1 minute to go. So, Mithat, let's try to make a quick question and Marcos a quick answer.
Okay. Ahead, so, I had two questions, but let me pick one quickly. So, question is a variant of what I asked Sergey yesterday. So if you were to consider the connection between complexified Chern-Simons theory and N equal 4 Spurian-Yields theory, so if you look to the gradient flow equation of the Chern-Simons theory, they map to the instanton equations, in the complexified instanton equations in the topologically twisted N equal 4. So I assume that when you are on a Stokes line, there has to be some flow between abelian connections, which are saddles of the complexified theory, right? So, and I would like to understand, what this story means from the 4D point of view.
I haven't thought about that. I think this might be an important ingredient because it's a complete description of this structure, but I don't really know the precise connection. And here we don't really have abelian connections here. I mean, here we have all these flat connections, and I think.
Oh, I'm sorry. I meant flat connections.
Okay. Yeah. So I think this information that we are unveiling might be important in this connection, but I haven't really thought about the concrete meaning of this.
Okay. Thanks.
Okay. Thank you very much, Marcos. That was wonderful.